Hi, and welcome back to another episode of Leaving the Farm right here on Revolution Radio, freedomslips.com, where information never sleeps. We are a listener-supported radio station. One, if you'd like to donate, please visit us at www.freedomslips.com and click on our support pages. Every little bit helps. We're also simulcasting tonight, of course, TammyPepperman.org, No Borders Radio at noBordersRadio.co.uk. Of course, we are always listener-supported. If you'd like to donate, please find our donate button on the TammyPepperman.org homepage, which of course donates to TamworthWebDevelopment.co.uk, which is our web development. Doing all of this out of the kindness, goodness of their hearts. Yesterday on the public law, we were covering a story on Charlize Theron. Our judge made quite a big hullabaloo. Arkansas judge loses job over that one. In a story from CNN.com, top court judge in Arkansas has ordered the immediate dismissal of a judge who leaked confidential details about an adoption involving Oscar-winning actress Charlize Theron, according to court documents. Now, everybody who is not aware of this, I mean, this guy's absolutely racist. He's pulling the race card. He's absolutely vile. And it's nice to see that he's up for dismissal here. Ferguson is back in the news, along with others in that area. Bloomberg.com. Arrests from Financial Bedrock across St. Louis County. Arrests form Financial Bedrock across St. Louis County towns. The lifeblood of the tiny St. Louis suburb of Beverly Hills is lawbreakers, whose traffic fines account for more than half the annual revenue. In nearby St. Anne, 39% of the general fund budget comes from court fines and fees. North St. Louis County, a predominantly black area, where the U.S. Justice Department is investigating the August 9th shooting of an unarmed teenager by a white, it says, police officer. I was FBI, of course. Ferguson, penance for crimes and misdemeanors, pays to fix streets, pay workers' salaries, and pick up trash in places once sustained by jobs at auto and aerospace factories, towns and cities that have been losing population, rely on scofflaws for funds. Think about that for a minute, folks. As Nazi Germany plays out right before your eyes. Hitler also lost all the jobs. Corporations all moved out of Poland. And this is all after Bayer Corporation, Bayerisch, came in as the Republic of Germany in 1928 and asked to indemnify Poland. Most listeners, most citizens of the United States Incorporated are not aware that your indemnification came with the 1802 Indemnification Convention that established a venue to insert those little enablement acts called state constitutions, which formed the original Reichsrat out of the Reichstag. Nazi Germany did not enter into the Confederate Union until 1933 with Hitler's acts of enablements. Hitler, of course, was only a mouthpiece for Congress. Hitler's eugenic program did not start with Hitler in Nazi Germany. It started with Planned Parenthood. It started with Nietzsche. It started with Malthusian theory. And it ramped up with the 1924 Racial Integrity Act of Congress. This is no laughing matter, folks. You are witnessing Auschwitz American style. France24.com, Air France cancels 60% of flights in week-long strike. Interesting. Air France will operate only 40% of its flights from Monday as pilots begin a one-week strike over company plans to cut costs to recapture market share from budget airlines, the airline said in a statement on Saturday. Speaking to France Interradio earlier in the day, Chief Executive Frédéric Gagey repeated that the strike, which could run until September 22nd, would cost the airline between 10 and 15 million euros a day. Europe's second largest traditional carrier by revenue said in early September it would move ahead with a plan to open new bases in Europe under the Transavia brand to recapture market share from low-cost carriers and Middle East rivals. Interesting how these little business plays work out to the detriment of citizens across the globe as the IMF jumps right in there to control the inflation rate as it controls every other commodity on the planet. From Breitbart.com, will Senator Wainwright's jail sentence change the culture of the Capitol? Friday, after more than a half year of delays, State Senator Rod Wright was sentenced to 90 days in jail after having been found guilty in January of felony counts of election fraud and perjury. Wright had been prosecuted by the Los Angeles District Attorney's Office for lying about being a resident of the state Senate seat for which he ran and which he represents in the legislature. In California, there's a requirement that all members of the California legislature must reside in their districts. In addition to being sentenced to 90 days in jail, Judge Kathleen Kennedy also ordered Wright to conduct 1,500 hours of community service. With the formal entering of felony convictions, Wright will now have a lifetime ban on future service in elective office. That's okay. They just move him into the banking industry, which is the same thing anyway. From Carolina.com, CarolinaLive.com, South Carolina House Speaker Harrell suspends himself from office. There's a new twist. Are we jumping ship there? Columbia, South Carolina. South Carolina House Speaker Bobby Harrell has suspended himself from office a day after a grand jury indicted him on charges of misconduct and using campaign donations for personal use. Harrell said in a statement, quote, Thursday, he believes it's the best decision for the House and the people of South Carolina. Speaker Pro Tem J. Lucas of Hartsville will immediately step up as Speaker. Harrell is charged with 9 misdemeanor counts. Lucas says Harrell is doing the right thing according to the law, requiring the suspension of a legislator charged with a crime punishable by more than 1 year in prison. One of the misdemeanors Harrell is charged with carries a potential sentence of 2 years. Lucas is among at least 4 legislators seeking to be elected speaker. I think I've got Bo with me. Are you there?
Yeah, I was dialing in, just listening. Yeah, well, I'll chime in here as you go along, if you'd like.
Yeah, I was just about getting into the good stuff here because this is absolutely deplorable. Maybe CNews.go.com, man sues jail after losing 5 toes in a Colorado jail. This, of course, is coming out of the AP. A man who lost 5 toes to diabetes while incarcerated at Arapaho County Jail has filed a lawsuit claiming the loss was due to lack of medical care. Lawsuit filed in federal court alleges that corrections health care companies failed to properly provide medical treatment to James Niesler. The Denver Post reported Saturday that Niesler suffered a broken blister on his right big toe from ill-fitting boots worn while he worked in the kitchen. Now, who's at fault here? Because this guy was injured on purpose. Of course, it's on the directives of corporate counsel. Scott K. Summers allowed us a little insight into the workings of corporate counsel when he said he must have a diagnosis in order to discharge congressional bankruptcy as a conservator from McHenry County, Illinois. And this happens day after day after day after day. Last night on the Public Law, you and I were covering a story on the NFL. And I was reminded of Tracy Morgan. You know, when that guy, quote, accidentally rolled that limo, while researching that, that was a perfect, absolutely perfect pit maneuver. It was done in the design as law enforcement is taught to use the pit maneuver. He hit it at their direct right location to flip that bus. And ultimately, when you get into the dynamics of this business schematic, you find that insurers are cashing in like you would not believe. Hedge fund management is cashing in like you would not believe. And these poor actors, because they're given celebrity and such a title, they keep playing the game, even though it's costing them their own lives. And we've watched this just recently with Joan Rivers as well.
Yeah. Well, if you look at what it says here, even in the CNN story back from July 15th, the Walmart truck that rear-ended Morgan's limo was traveling 20 miles per hour over the speed limit, and its driver was almost at the drive time limit, according to preliminary report by National Transportation Safety Board. According to the complaint filed by lawyers acting for Morgan and three others, the truck driven by Walmart employee Kevin Roper collided with the rear end of Morgan's vehicle. So he just rear-ended him.
Absolutely. And it was in the precise location to roll that limo, and it ended up killing a human being and, of course, severely injuring Tracy Morgan to the tune of how much money that went into the medical industry and all of the related costs of rehabilitation, all of these things. Who's cashing in on these things? And you go back to the, quote, Walmart driver. Sam Walton was one of those listed on the original 1933 bankruptcy that Congress went into. That was all of them cronies that went bankrupt. Sam Walton is, of course, the original owner of Sam's and Walmart stores. And they just keep changing their names as they're discharging their own bankruptcies from back then, using human beings as fodder. And that's why I wanted
kind of like ISIS to ISIL to IS.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Because it's those are the
kind of like Blackwater changing his name to
Halliburton or Dick Cheney.
Yeah. Yeah, they got a new one now that they go under.
No, it's all the same corporation. But it was interesting.
They just reorganize it and shuffle it around, and people forget about it and goes under the rug.
Absolutely. The
they
biggest,
don't see it.
The largest was the 1648 Treaty of Westphalia. Oh, come on. Rome goes bankrupt, and then it reorganizes and calls itself Germany and Austria and France and Spain. And by 1941, it was only the United States of America, which is a style or chain of events. That was Rome. Rome was also a chain of events. Nazi Germany also was a chain of events. Cambodia was a chain of events. North Korea, Vietnam, that was a chain of events. It's a depopulation pogrom called a perpetual union, otherwise known as, quote, the United States of America. And you can read this in the Articles of Confederation. Canada is Article 11. And all of these things, it is Rome. It was Rome. And, you know, this is, it's just deplorable. The report we were reporting on last night was 1 in 3 NFL players have a head injury. And 1 in 3 retired NFL players are up for grabs when it comes to Alzheimer's and other brain disorders. And this, of course, goes into our vast amounts of research into guarantee insurance. You look at Casey Kasem, Joan Rivers, Tracy Morgan, Robin Williams. Robin Williams was a different design. They used the family court and related financial burden maintained by Fourth Generation Warfare to get him to kill himself, because that's Clean Hands Doctrine. That is the ultimate Clean Hands Doctrine. If somebody's back channel or behind the scenes terrorizing somebody else until they with their own hands kill themselves, it leaves the original actor, the director, not culpable, or so they think. Now, when you have those amounts that those courts were ordering for Robin Williams, that is evidence of Fourth Generation Warfare, asymmetrical warfare.
That's yeah, I put together a whole report on that Robin Williams, there's an astounding amount of evidence that he was destroyed by court process.
Absolutely.
I mean, they were draining him so hard with those alimony payments. And for what? Because he had, more money. The spouse gets more money.
That was just an
employment by the court system to redistribute the mail under the rules of feminism, which was funded through the IMF. And we didn't start breaking that up until last year.
Federal Reserve. And you look at Casey Kasem. Under what cartoon can anybody be living under when a daughter is given more rights over the wife? You know, that these horrifying examples are examples of the court process raising, R-A-Z-I-N-G, everybody on the planet.
Now we just had, this is just hot off the press from the Daily Mail, daughter of Dog the Bounty Hunter, Lissa Chapman, 27, is involved in a serious car crash in Hawaii along with her two young children.
Oh.
Daughter of Dog the Bounty Hunter and her two children have been involved in a serious car accident in Hawaii. Lissa Chapman, 27, was in the car along with her two young daughters, Abby, 12, and Madeline, 5, when the accident occurred. Lissa's black four-door vehicle was involved in a collision in her hometown in Honolulu, Hawaii, according to TMZ. Let's see if I can get more information here on the actual crash. The front end of the car appears to be completely destroyed, while photos show the airbags were deployed inside the vehicle. Emergency services were called immediately after the wreck, and the video shows the ambulances were on the scene.
Wow, they were close. I wonder what that's all about.
The road ended up being covered with other debris from the collision, including plastic from the bumper and shattered glass from the headlights. Yeah, of course, everything's made out of plastic on your cars these days.
Absolutely.
So there's more of a propensity for these, harmful collisions now.
Injury. It's all about injury.
Remember back in the 50s, they made everything out of solid steel.
Absolutely.
Those cars were like 4,000 pounds each or more.
The death rate was so low back then on car accidents.
Yeah, people didn't wear seat belts or have power steering or
That's
anything like that.
That's not good for the United States Incorporated. You gotta make everything out of plastic so it falls apart.
Let's see here. This is Mother Beth, who confirmed that her daughter and grandchildren had been involved in the accident, although there is no information at the present time as to whether or not any of them were injured. The 27-year-old starred on the A&E reality show with her father, Dwayne Dog Chapman, her mother Beth, and various friends and relatives, including Cecily Bearmore Chapman, Dwayne Chapman Jr., Leland Chapman, Gary Chapman, and Bonnie Chapman. The show follows the family of bounty hunters as they track down wanted fugitives.
Yeah.
There's not much information on the crash
there. I've seen that one, and it's most likely not due to the bounty hunting, but Beth has a pretty nice size rack on her, and I'm pretty sure that one attracted more visitors than the other one.
Yeah. I never really watched the show more than a couple minutes, so I don't know.
I wonder if I can say it on the air. It's more like a flotation device. Big Story AP.org is reporting rampant Ebola fear takes toll on African tourism. Now, how is that for your corporate government? Come on, you've got a whole bunch of people dying, human beings dying, and yet corporations are worried about their tourism and revenue streams because of the fears of Ebola. These are the practices, of course, of attorneys in action, and as we've said before, keep patronizing it if you enjoy this kind of treatment. It's very interesting, these things.
Yes. You know, along the lines of the NFL, you know, we really broke down how they're really just coming down on NFL players and demonizing the whole sport with the disclosure now finally of how all these players have to suffer and endure, you know, injuries for the rest of their life after their short-lived career, because how long does an NFL career last? I guarantee you there's not many that go as long as the baseball careers.
No.
You know, you get too beat up in football, and, you know, that's the nature of the sport. It was...
boxing, those are all those gladiator arenas. They call them football arenas. They're just the arena. It's gladiators. And here you have a bunch of attorneys, a bunch of hedge fund management bankers betting on not only these games, but on the injury rates and on the medical industry and on the psychological industry.
How about the lawsuits that are going on now?
Absolutely.
With
racism, sexual harassment, rape, domestic violence? There's a whole world or global enterprise within just one of these gladiator pits or football arenas. I mean, it's just absolutely astounding because, indoctrination provides these football players or these actors or actresses with this celebrity, and it makes them feel good, when in reality they're being preyed on more so than just the average human being, because they can be insured at higher rates. They bring in more revenue, and all of this controversy, of course, who does it benefit? Who benefits off of controversy, though?
Attorneys.
And, of course, this stems directly out of the rules of war. 1864 Geneva Convention, 1929 Geneva Convention. This says these corporations are just raking it in hand over fist, and every bit of it is outside of the public law. Farming.
So right hand in hand with the NFL, you know, and how it relates to entertainment. Now, Breiber just came out with this story today, and it's titled Hollywood Code Red, 2014 already a write-off, 19% of jobs cut. When you combine Variety's story about a 19% drop in entertainment industry jobs, and the Hollywood Reporter story about the 2014 box office already being written off as a disaster, things look pretty glum in the business of show, and probably for good reason. No one expected summer 2014 to tank, no one. Everyone's saying, wait till next year. But this year, there was a Spider-Man, some X-Men, a bunch of apes, more Transformers, a Godzilla, a gaggle of Expendables, Adam Sandler and Melissa McCarthy, oh, and two Marvel movies. Moreover, this past Labor Day weekend was the worst since the post 9/11 Labor Day weekend. What is scary for the film business is that other than Guardians of the Galaxy, almost everything underperformed. Even a huge opening meant nothing, because the following weekend's dropped off was so steep. Sure, money was made overseas, but advertising and promotion are more expensive, and the cut of the gross is oftentimes smaller. In China, for example, studios only see a 25% return.
And John Kerry, John Forbes Kerry is the...
And here's the big one. And no one knows why. No one can explain it.
Yeah.
And that has everyone worried.
John Forbes Kerry is falling down on the job.
Yeah, maybe we need to explain it here.
John Forbes Kerry is on the Board of Governors, at the Broadcasting Board of Governors, and it looks like he's falling down on the job and not a very good governor there, perhaps. And something more interesting too, all of these actors and actresses losing their jobs and things like this, this allows them to be preyed on by the local corporate counsel attorneys. And after a layoff, of course, what follows is you get a letter from the IRS. You owe back taxes that you didn't know about. Or CPS comes calling because of an anonymous caller, or Adult Protection comes calling because of an anonymous caller, or you happen to be in a limo and it's pit maneuvered to kill your friend and injure yourself to the benefit of these vicious attorneys.
Can't say that enough. I mean, everyone wants to, you know, in the alternative media, you have those out there that call them the globalists, the oligarchs, bankers. I mean, those are all smokescreen terms for attorney.
Absolutely.
I mean, who do you think oligarchs rely on? They're attorneys and their attorney work product doctrine. That's why, you know, a bank, which you call a bank, is really a law firm. It's got a board of attorneys at the top running that
bank.
And who handles all the legal affairs of a bank? Attorneys.
Absolutely.
The bank is facilitated in that court process through 28 United States Code 453, the judge's oath, where his oath involves discharging his duties. Okay, discharge. Okay, it's the word that synonymous with this, with offset. Okay, and duties are monies. They're discharging congressional bankruptcy.
Absolutely.
That's their oath.
Man, for all of our new listeners, go ahead and I'll reach into my Black's Law Dictionary, first edition, 1891. Go to the definition of bank. Number one, a bench or seat. The bench or tribunal occupied by the judges. The seat of judgment. A court. Period. The full bench or full court. The assembly of all the judges of a court. A sitting in bank is a meeting of all the judges of a court, usually for the purpose of hearing arguments on demurrers, points reserved, motions for new trial, etc., is distinguished from the sitting in of a single judge at the Assizi or at Nisi Prius and from trials at bar. But in this sense, bank, B-A-N-C, is the more usual form of the word. Number two, an institution of great value in the commercial world, empowered to receive deposits of money, to make loans, and to issue its promissory notes designed to circulate as money and commonly called bank notes or bank bills, or to perform any one of the or more of these functions. The term bank is usually restricted in its application to an incorporated body, while a private individual making it his business to conduct banking operations is denominated a banker. Now, for those of you that are not aware of the 1933 Emergency Banking Act,
which is found under Title 12 of the United States Code, by the way. Title 11, they wrote first, was the Bankruptcy Code, and it was a setup for Title 12.
Absolutely.
Way before the bankruptcy ever occurred,
right,
these blocks were put in place for their bankruptcy building.
Right, which was the 1929 Geneva Convention, maintaining that if somebody lost their government or it went bankrupt or something, corporations would step in and pick them up as prisoners of war. And we'll go to 12 U.S.C. subsection 73 to the attorney oath under the Banking Act. Each director, when appointed or elected, shall take an oath that he will. Oops. Now I've got some.
Well, it's getting pretty bad when Cornell's got to run pop-ups.
I think it was me. I'll just start over. 12 U.S.C. subsection 73, oath. Each director, when appointed or elected, shall take an oath that he will, so far as the duty devolves on him, diligently and honestly administer the affairs of such association and will not knowingly violate or willingly permit to be violated any of the provisions of Title 62 of the Revised Statutes and that he is the owner in good faith, Article 12, the Articles of Confederation, all humans were pledged to discharge congressional bankruptcy in good faith, and in his own right, of the numbers of shares of stock required by Title 62 of the revised statutes subscribed by him or standing in his name on the books of the association, and that the same is not hypothecated or in any way pledged as security for any loan or debt. He's saying, hey, look, only the natural person can be a surety, which refers to the human being having been naturalized or born in the United States, incorporated by legal instrument, banking instrument known as a birth certificate, that's a receipt, and of a bill of lading. You're parking the vessel on their dock. You're docking that child. So that is a receipt. It's called a birth certificate. Well, at that time, the attorney's pledging, well, I'm not hypothecated. That little baby is. I'm not responsible for my debt. Your child is responsible for my debt.
Now, in that word hypothecate, I mean, simply put, it means to render into a negotiable instrument.
Right, or turn into a theory.
And they've been hypothecating human beings since, forever, but in this current experiment of the United States of America, the Articles of Confederation. Article 1, it says, you know, the style of this confederacy shall be the United States of America. And then you go to Title 12, and what does it say? It says that you're all pledged as assets, you know, in order to offset their congressional bankruptcy. Now, I'm paraphrasing, but go read it.
Absolutely. And this is why we've been so angry, folks, because we're watching it play out again.
I also got to point in, it's tied in with, you know, Amjur, second edition, under Bills and Notes. All right, this is the concept. They set up the 1789 Judiciary Act with, and that allowed these courts, which you call a court, was actually allowed to be created as a place of business. And if you look at Article 3 in the Judiciary Act of 1789, you'll see the routing system.
Start of the routing system.
Yeah.
Between the districts and the circuits.
And of course, that was along with, you know, 13
original
states.
Original banks. They all established themselves as banks with their original charters. That is what a charter is.
And of course, they had to expand out from there, you know, and they did so through acts of enablement starting in 1802.
Absolutely. It just ramped it up, because once they've used a populace all up and raised it to the ground, call all of the populace, get rid of the overhead. That's exactly what they did in Nazi Germany. Bayer Corporation came in as the Republic of Germany and asked the court, the world courts, Congress's courts, to indemnify Poland. After that, what happened? All the overhead was cut. It wasn't that they were walking human beings into gas chambers and in front of firing squads and melting them in boxcars and such. It was a business deal, cutting the overhead. And as everybody knows, Hitler and his propaganda minister considered human beings is simply useless bread gobblers. And again, Henry Kissinger, Secretary of State, 1974, came in his Memorandum 200 to the National Security Council, and remember, that secures the nations, not this state, which is a human being, and he said depopulation should be the highest priority of all foreign policy, all of your communication. And of course, who's at the head of foreign policy? Henry Kissinger. Well, why? That Secretary of State is always sitting on the Board of Governors, at the Broadcasting Board of Governors, ensuring that foreign policy is what he wants it to be. Or she, because Hillary Clinton was another human trafficker and perpetrator of genocide. For Black's Law Dictionary, 8th edition, the letter A, usually capitalized and often italicized, means a hypothetical person, and it refers to a deed's black acre. Now, it'll take me a moment now to get to that, Bo, but I know you've touched on it before, but, you know, this is getting absolutely
I read it all in the air. It's from page 2 of Black's edition 8, letter A, and it tells you. They're assigning you. No, you're assigned at birth due to your mother unknowingly and wittingly signing you over on the birth certificate.
As the informant.
As informant. And the people in the law movement out there want to argue that instrument. Okay? We didn't do that in my case.
No.
We argued the assignment ability. That's what it's all about.
Yeah, it's the action, the first action of genocide. You can't take a baby and wrap a millstone around its neck. Period.
But that's what they did.
Right.
And that's part of the reason we came up against them.
Right. And won. You know, now they're all pissy because they lost the war. Well, how else could this have gone? Here they perpetrate under acts of commerce and private acts. They use attorney work product doctrine, case law, common law, and retard an entire populace of attorneys teaching them these concepts. Well, when truth is revealed, truth comes in and it says, well, you don't have any standing at all. And what happens? Everything falls to pieces because you're dealing with, and you witness this yourself from start to finish, you're dealing with just these dead brain or brain dead psychopaths that like defending their title.
Yeah, they only like arguing statute. They, you know, rely on statute as their crutch, and the statute has no place under the public law, under the restricted principle of sovereign immunity. Hey, you telling me about your ridiculous statutes, okay? I'm talking about human trafficking and genocide here. Oh, no, well, we don't want to talk about that. That's not according to the court procedures.
Right.
Yada, yada, yada. Read through the case and read these baloney comebacks from these attorneys and judges.
Right. And especially defending title. I mean, that was the funniest part, is that, you know, these narcissists, it's always the same. And that's the story of Narcissus. He's out there looking at his own reflection in a pool of water until he died. And that's exactly what the attorneys do. Here they are. They're defending title. They're not defending truth or anything tangible at all or anything withstanding. They're defending all these titles and formatter and all of these other concepts from that tree of knowledge.
Now, you were talking about Hillary Clinton.
They've been using old pictures of her now. They're trying to make her look really sweet and innocent.
Oh, yeah, and they're trying to paint her up as the victim here. Or, you know, this is what happens when they get called out on their criminal activity and stuff. Hillary Clinton says Bill was subjected to South African-style hearings in order to work through his affair with intern Monica Lewinsky. Well, this came out in the Daily Mail today. So, let's see here. The points on this are Hillary Clinton has revealed that she worked through her husband's affair whilst he was president by making him go through an agonizing truth and reconciliation process. The former U.S. Secretary of State said that she forced Bill Clinton into South Africa-style hearings where he had to be completely honest before she forgave him. She said she was inspired by the country's former leader, Nelson Mandela, and that she had to act, otherwise she would remain in a mental prison for the rest of her life.
Oh, come on.
Poor Hillary.
No, remember back then, he had a feminist PR rep, right?
Yeah.
So they were trying to paint Hillary Clinton as, you know, a female, and then all of a sudden she brought up Tammy Wynette, remember? Now her story's changing to Nelson Mandela. But back then, she brought up the Tammy Wynette song, Stand By Your Man. Remember how she made that famous once again, attempting to present the illusion that she was a female? And she's about as vicious as it gets. And the definition of black acre out of Black's Law Dictionary, edition 2004. A fictitious tract of land used in legal discourse, especially law school hypotheticals, to discuss real property issues. When another tract of land is needed in a hypothetical, it is often termed, quote, white acre. Quote, Black Acre is the most celebrated tract of land in the world of law. Black Acre is wholly mythical, yet totally real. It is a concept living in the realm of the mind and doubly valuable since much of the law of property has the same type of reality, end quote. And that was a quote from John E. Cribbett, Principles of the Law of Property, 2, 2nd edition, 1975. It's interesting because, you know, Hillary Clinton likes playing with black and white acres. As Secretary of State, she's a clearinghouse.
Right.
In charge.
Formerly when she was Secretary of State.
Oh, she's going to be held accountable for that.
Well, yeah, she did what she did.
Absolutely. She's absolutely
predatory. It's like this thing about...
predatory in nature.
Yeah, it's this thing about Bill Clinton. He did what he did.
Absolutely.
He had an affair, you know.
And
he was preying on an intern.
Right.
And then he lied about it. Okay. All right, that's the nature of your Confederacy, your leadership, right in your face, people. They always lie.
And it's always like that. You know, Jeff used to joke about that. He grew up in Boston.
If they're lying about affairs, what... really, you know, are they lying about that really matters?
He said a very distinct quote around the time of these occurrences. He said, you know, they're just out turning pages.
He went out and missile attacked somebody just to offed a bunch of people just to divert the attention away from his affair.
Absolutely. And not just that. You know, look at how much Kenneth Starr cashed in. That was all of them fee splitting and fee sharing. So Clintons, they never lost anything. That was sensationalized and made them famous. And that's how it works. Actors, any kind of controversy makes them famous, no matter how bad they are. Look at Michael Vick.
And people just love to be entertained, don't they?
Absolutely.
I guess that's part of the predictive programming and, you know, the things they instilled upon us and their process of making us good products of the American Confederacy.
Yeah.
Or, well, it's a global Confederacy, but...
it's a chain of events. From Newsday.com, NYPD off-duty... state narcotics agent arrested in Manhattan shooting. And we're going to play the scripting game again. An off-duty state narcotics agent carrying a pistol was arrested after a shooting in Manhattan's Upper West Side on Friday night left two people injured, New York City police said. The gun belonging to Victor Zambrano, 49, of Manhattan, went off as he was arguing with a woman he'd been drinking with earlier in the evening. Yeah, it just went off. You know, that's what happens. Guns get excited and they just fire up without any finger on the trigger. 31-year-old woman suffered an injury to her foot, possibly from a bullet, while a 42-year-old man with the pair was shot in the leg, police said. The shooting happened around 9 p.m. on Amsterdam Avenue near 82nd Street, prompting pedestrians and diners at restaurants in the bustling neighborhood to duck for cover. The man and woman were taken to the hospital with non-life-threatening injuries, police said. Zambrano is charged with criminal possession of a weapon, resisting arrest, reckless endangerment, and two counts of assault, police said. He was to be arraigned late Saturday. He's a member of the State Bureau of Narcotic Enforcement, which combats illegal use and trafficking of prescription drugs, police said. A call to the Bureau seeking comment was not returned. Interesting. These upholders of the commercial law finding themselves in this shoot.
Now, let's see here. Just out today... medical director of Manhattan Clinic, where Joan Rivers went into cardiac arrest, steps down after he let an unauthorized doctor examine Starr. Dr. Lawrence B. Cohen, who performed the procedure on the Starr at a Manhattan clinic before she stopped breathing and went into cardiac arrest, and stepped down.
CNN came out with a timeline today on CNN.com reports a new timeline emerging in the emergency response to comedian Joan Rivers' cardiac arrest. 9:40 a.m., a 911 call from the Yorkville Clinic reports a patient in cardiac arrest. 9:45, the New York Fire Department response team arrives at the clinic and finds CPR efforts on Rivers already underway with the defibrillator attached and a breathing tube inserted into her windpipe. Firefighters take over the CPR efforts. 9:47, an ambulance from Mount Sinai arrives. 9:48, a second NYFD unit with emergency medical technicians along with the supervisor arrive at the clinic. 9:50, a total of 10 rescue workers are on the scene. Rivers, 81, was rushed to Mount Sinai Hospital where she died a week later. Yorkville Endoscopy said in a statement this week that Dr. Lawrence Cohen is, quote, is not currently performing procedures, nor is he currently serving as medical director, end quote. The statement did not say that his departure was connected to Rivers' death, and clinic spokeswoman Marsha Horowitz declined to elaborate. In a statement, the Manhattan clinic said that the cardiac arrest did not happen during her elective procedure, and responding to reports of a biopsy said, quote, a biopsy of the vocal cords has never been performed at Yorkville Endoscopy. Many questions have been raised about what treatment was given and what might have gone wrong that led to the comedian's death. Few answers have been made public because of medical privacy rules, but the New York State Health Department confirmed the agency is investigating. The clinic's stated statement also seemed to address speculation that her cardiac arrest could have been related to the anesthesia used to sedate Rivers while an endoscope, which is a long, flexible camera, was used to examine her throat. Quote, general anesthesia has never been administered at Yorkville Endoscopy, the statement said. The type of sedation used at Yorkville Endoscopy is monitored anesthesia care. Our anesthesiologists utilize light to moderate sedation. Only licensed medical doctors who are board certified anesthesiologists administer anesthesia at the clinic, the statement said. And it says, our anesthesiologists monitor the patient continuously, utilizing state-of-the-art monitoring equipment, and remain at the bedside throughout the procedure and into recovery. The clinic statement also deflected criticism that Rivers should have been treated in a hospital and not a clinic because of her advanced age. Quote, Yorkville Endoscopy has strict policies in place for the criteria of who gets treatment in this center versus in a hospital, the statement said. Quote, every patient is pre-screened by their gastroenterologist, an anesthesiologist, and a nurse for appropriateness to be treated at Yorkville Endoscopy. Some patients also are pre-screened by their personal physicians, end quote. It's interesting to see these things coming out, you know, in the mainstream media and, you know, pointing fingers and maintaining a license or not licensed or whatever. A human being is dead, and it was supposed to be a routine procedure, and we want to get to the bottom of that. From dailyfreeman.com, nurse charged with stealing oxycodone pills from patient at Northeast Center in Lake Katrine. Town of Ulster, a licensed practical nurse from Saugerties has been charged with stealing oxycodone pills from a paralyzed resident of the Northeast Center for Special Care in Lake Katrine, State Attorney General Eric T. Schneiderman said Wednesday. Amy DeAngelis Martin, 34, a former employee of the center, faces felony charges of endangering the welfare of an incompetent or physically disabled person and falsifying business records, and misdemeanor charges of criminal possession of a controlled substance and petty larceny. If convicted, she could serve up to 4 years in prison, Schneiderman said. The 52-year-old nursing home resident was paralyzed from the waist down due to a head and neck trauma and had been prescribed oxycodone for pain. On May 22, 2013, DeAngelis Martin allegedly took 3 oxycodone pills from the resident and replaced them with similar-looking loratadine pills, a generic form of Claritin, a non-narcotic allergy medication, according to a news release from Schneiderman's office. This is sick. Sick. You're horrifying. Shame on you. Sick. Nurses. from LIHerald.com, Bayview nurse charged after morphine probe. A Bayview nursing home nurse who gave morphine instead of a prescribed muscle relaxant to a wheelchair-bound resident 2 years ago and then tried to cover up the error was indicted on felony charges last week, according to the state attorney general's office. Attorney General Eric T. Schneiderman announced the unsealing of a felony indictment charging Vicki Price, 46, a licensed practical nurse, in connection with a morphine overdose of a patient at the Island Park Rehabilitation Center located at 1 Long Beach Road. If convicted, Price faces up to 4 years in prison. Now, morphine overdoses, there's a really high ceiling on morphine, and it's rare to see an actual overdose because morphine is designed to shut down the bodily functions anyway. So no matter what, it's always going to kill you, but there's no ceiling. I've never heard of a ceiling on it. It's interesting.
What'd you think about this breaking news about the shooting at Pennsylvania Police Barracks? Trooper killed.
Yeah, I'm wondering if that wasn't a hit by attorneys. Go ahead and read it. All I have is the information that I saw come through earlier, and being in connection with our law enforcement, I sent it off to them because it does look like those two law enforcement agents were whacked.
Well, we've got a long story at Yahoo, and then the basic breaking report at Investment Watch. I'll read that for time's sake. Blooming Grove, Pennsylvania. Pennsylvania State Police have confirmed to a TV news station that a shooting has occurred at the State Police Barracks in northeastern Pennsylvania. WNEP television station also reports that the Pike County coroner was called to the scene. The shooting occurred at the barracks in Blooming Grove, a township of about 4,000 people, about 35 miles east of Scranton. Many police and emergency vehicles responded and roadblocks were set up while a search is underway for the suspect. No one was in custody early Saturday morning.
Right, and that's what they've been saying, is that nobody saw the shooter, so it sounds like a sniper or something equivalent to what the FBI has always done. And again, it's with law enforcement, and hopefully they get to the bottom of it and don't allow the criminal actors to investigate, because it's, we don't do that under the public law.
State Police Commissioner Frank Noonan said a very dangerous armed criminal eluded quick capture, over from the Yahoo News write-up. This attack was an ambush. Our troopers were shot without warning and really had no chance to defend themselves. Noonan told reporters Saturday afternoon, it's a cowardly attack. It's an attack upon all of us in society.
Absolutely.
And what, when they introduce female rights and stuff like that, they do through Congress, all their congressional acts for that matter of fact, is that not a cowardly act?
Absolutely.
Cowardly attack?
And these things are deplorable, because now it looks like it was a hit called out by an attorney. But we don't have any more details than that. But my hearts go out to the families. This is terrible.
Well, yeah, I don't know how to feel unless I know some more details here. And, most cops out there are still brainwashed to be the lapdogs for their attorney masters, you know. With that IQ that they were hired with to be under 110, according to that ABC report going back to 1999. And, the attorneys are going to throw these cops under the bus when things start going south. And
right.
If that's what happened here, that's what it looks like.
It's corporate counsels cashing in on their death derivatives, insurance claims, because the cops were employed by them. And it's horrifying. And again, we'll update as we are able. From RT.com today, guilty Russell tribunal condemns Obama, Poroshenko war crimes in the Ukraine. presidents of the Ukraine and the U.S., in addition to heads of NATO and the European Commission, have been condemned for war crimes in eastern Ukraine by an informal Russell tribunal, which took place in Venice, Italy, on Saturday. The show trial in Venice was inspired by the Russell Tribunal, organized by British philosopher and Nobel Prize winner Bertrand Russell, and hosted by French philosopher and writer Jean-Paul Sartre in 1966 to investigate U.S. war crimes in Vietnam. Further tribunals focused on human rights violations in the dictatorships of Argentina and Brazil, 1973, Chile's military coup, 1974 through 76, on human rights in psychiatry in 2001, on Iraq 2004, and on Palestine 2009 through 2012. We'll be right back, folks. Stick around. We'll just get right back into it. Again, you're listening to Leaving the Farm right here on Revolution Radio, freedomslips.com, where information never sleeps. We are a listener-supported radio station. If you'd like to donate, please visit us at www.freedomslips.com and click on our support pages. Every little bit helps. We're also simulcasting on tammypepperman.org. If you'd like to donate to our web hosting service, development, please do so at the donate button located under the No Borders radio player, which of course is also located at www.noBordersRadio.co.uk. You can also find us on Twitter and Facebook and all sorts of stuff.
You know, one thing that we didn't hit too much on this week, and it is the week where the 13th year anniversary of the 9/11 incident occurred. And, and it's just, it was just a bigger operation than normal, but it was right out of the playbook of Book 4, Church Committee Detailed Staff Reports and
Foreign Military Intelligence.
Yeah, that we talk about all the time. Now let's see, apparently we hit some headlines on that. 9/11 firefighter blows World Trade Center Building 7 cover up wide open in a hour and 30 minute presentation on Vimeo. Building 7 was always the smoking gun. It went down 20 or 30 minutes after the BBC reported it coming down? It was still standing when they said, oh, the Building 7 has come down. And if that wasn't in your face enough, going back to when the first building went down, when it fell at near free fall speeds and people believed that a building could actually, fall like that, that was built plane crashes in mind. I mean, that just shows you how what the Congress actually thinks of you mentally.
Right.
I mean,
they treat them like infants.
They know that nobody takes physics and sciences these days in high school. They introduce things like home ec in high school to keep you busy. I remember.
Right, but there's tons of job openings for social workers. We don't have to be educated or anything. We just need to follow policy.
Yeah, and but just as a reminder, 10 seconds was just a little over free fall speed. All right, each one of those floors was a major obstacle unless they were pre-cut. That's all there is to it. Unless it was set up to be imploded and to implode into its own footprint. I mean, it's preposterous to coin a term.
That word means to posture, preposterous. And, of course, that's
and the American people were,
does.
They were pre-postured due to the dumbing down of America, before that happened.
Absolutely.
They know they can sell you anything.
Treaties on education.
And they did. They sold, most of the people bought it. But there's a hardcore, people that kept, not believing the mainstream line. And, you know, some of them, although were, they knew that the movement was going to come, so they got right in there and co-opted it from the beginning.
Absolutely.
Talking about,
I can sum it up into one sentence.
Yeah.
From the Gelnhausen Charter, April 13th, 1180. In the name of the Holy and Indivisible Trinity, Frederick, by favor of the Divine Mercy, August Emperor of the Romans, since human memory is short and does not suffice for a crowd of things, the authority of those who preceded our age, the Divine Emperors and Kings, has decreed that those things were to be written down, which the progress of fleeting time generally removes from the knowledge of men. You're going to forget about this anyway. We're just going to tell you a bunch of dead guys set this up, and you're going to buy it. We're going to cash in on these things. And, of course, 1180 is also followed by the Exchequer.
Yeah, 1180 is when the dialogue of the Exchequer began, and it continued for a while. Just like a chess game, yeah.
It requires very limited mental capacity. It requires low IQs. It requires a preconceived attention span of 7 minutes, which is what it is now, thanks to media theory, hegemony, and related indoctrination. 7 minutes. So the average, quote, American citizen globally has an average of a 7 minute attention span. And during that time, it's very quick to forget in between, especially if you're introduced to the silent weapon for quiet words, which is the computer. You've got tons of stuff you can be doing. You can be doing your Excel spreadsheets or working on a Word document. And to the side, there's a whole bunch of games you can play. You can go play on Facebook. You can Google Twitter, your little heart out. Google Plus. You've got all these things that you can be doing other than holding them accountable. And, of course, this all stems from their preconceived and built, created, socially engineered aspect of cognitive dissonance. You're going to fall back on the easier to believe truth. You don't want to believe that Washington never existed. The word Washington means the state of a man named Wasso, which stems from the word vassal, meaning one who pledges allegiance to another. And you can be told that these dead guys really loved you, and that is why they established a Bill of Revival to usurp you, called the Bill of Rights, and that's why they declared you dead at the Declaration of Independence and lost at sea, because they were such good folks. These were just amazing folks, weren't they, Bo?
Most people didn't even know that there was a president until Lincoln got assassinated, right? Allegedly.
Right. Nobody asked, what's a president? They're like, oh my gosh, a president got shot?
What's a president?
Yeah. You know, that's what established.
I mean, think about it. They didn't have the media. They didn't have, like, you know, the internet and stuff.
No.
You know?
And
so
they didn't have television.
What did people know? They knew that they had to get up and figure out how they were going to eat that day. You know?
Right. And then they had to fight over slavery. And that's something that's so profound. Here's all these citizens, white and black people, living together. And all of a sudden, Congress promotes a law that says slavery is legal. And then you have corporations move in on your people. And they start putting people into slavery. And then everybody else is like, what the hell is going on? Everybody starts killing each other on behalf of Congress. That was Congress's dirty deeds. But without the mainstream media back then, without the internet, without the television programming, everybody's just sitting ducks like they are in Syria right now. Iraq, Afghanistan, Ukraine, Russia. And you wonder why these places are censored with Facebook and everything else. They don't want their populace knowing that Congress is moving in on them. They don't want the populace knowing that they're about to be picked up as prisoners of war by corporations. And they sure as hell don't want everybody knowing that John Forbes Kerry is the clearinghouse discharging congressional bankruptcy.
Yeah, but did you rely on this dumbing down. They're so confident they could sell you anything through the media, which is overseen globally by the BBG.
Watch.
You know, and right. And they've been pushing this man-made global warming stuff. And their mouthpiece, you know, out of the new Cosmos series, A Space-Time Odyssey, that mouthpiece for Congress, disgusting, Neil deGrasse Tyson, okay? He's the new Carl Sagan, allegedly.
Aww.
You know, that...
perverting the minds of humanity as a whole.
Oh, and there's, you know, like 90% of it's all good, you know, astronomy and stuff like that. But, you know, then that push...
Absolutely.
To get you to buy
that
people driving around in their cars for the last 100 years has caused all this global warming.
Absolutely.
When in fact it's the corporations spewing out all this carbon. And even with all that, that's just a drop in the bucket, a needle in the haystack for the amount of carbon that gets released into the air from one volcanic eruption.
Absolutely, and look at the concept. You just went right through it. So you have the action or the war tactic of winning hearts and minds. It buys, it sells you these things, and you buy into these things, and you feel comfortable in these things, and then all of a sudden it starts trying to wipe your mind, erase all of your thoughts, and indoctrinate you to a new realm of thinking. And this is what they're doing on the ground in the UK and Russia, Syria, right now. Because
yeah.
Here's the FBI promoting these wars, killing human beings, just like Ferguson, Missouri. And what happens after that? Their same corporate handlers come in and say, here, honey, here's a bag of rice for you because you've been so destructive. And we, you know, somebody blew up your house and raised your community. And we'll give you some rice and bread and stuff.
Food and look who's behind Cosmos, if that's not telling. Seth MacFarlane.
Aww.
All right? That's Robot Chicken.
Family Guy.
Yeah, I mean,
Family
entertainment.
Guy. It's Rob Ford.
Entertainment and
they're
consensus
same,
reality.
They're using the same character to take out Rob Ford.
American Dad, he's the co-creator of the shows American Dad, The Cleveland Show. He's the creator of Family Guy.
Most of Americans watch those religiously, though. For entertainment, they think they're being entertained, when in reality, it's soft-selling pedophilia. There's this old guy in the Family Guy cartoon that really likes to prey on children, but it's maintained that it's funny.
It's
maintained that it's funny, so that you're less likely to go after a pedophile in your neighborhood. You're not going to kill him, right? It's funny.
Maybe he wasn't Robot Chicken, but yeah, certainly Family Guy, which is huge. And that's, you know,
American Dad, CIA
that's
indoctrination.
More, yeah, that's more CIA indoctrination.
CIA is your friend. CIA is your friend. Look at this. It's funny when the CIA raises you. American Dad, it's funny. That's funny. It's
oh, this
funny
last season was amazing, though, because they had to start telling the truth, and they came out with some amazing disclosure about the CIA and American
Absolutely.
Dad this last season.
Absolutely. Well, the genocide order says it. You're no longer allowed to indoctrinate people. From RT.com today, this was just, I really like this article, although it's horrifyingly sad. The headline reads, quote, "His hands were up. New footage shows Ferguson witnesses reacting to teen's death." New footage of the moments just after Ferguson, Missouri, teenager Michael Brown was killed by a local police officer, which is an FBI agent, indicates that a witness on the scene said the unarmed 18-year-old hands were raised while he was fatally shot. The video, released by CNN, shows several witnesses gathering in the vicinity of Brown's slaying, attention focused on the spot where Ferguson police officer Darren Wilson shot and killed the unarmed teenager early last month, the network reported. Quote, "He had his effing hands in the air," the man called a contractor working in the area by CNN shouted. The worker, who said he was not from Ferguson and did not want to be identified, told CNN the teen's hands were up when he was killed. "The cop didn't say, get on the ground. He kept shooting," the man told CNN. He added that he saw Brown's, quote, and I apologize to our listeners, "brains come out of his head," end quote, again emphasizing, quote, "his hands were up," end quote. The man's fellow construction worker seen in the video next to the first man said Brown was running away from the police officer. Brown, quote, put his hands up, end quote, the second contractor said, and, quote, the officer was chasing him, end quote. He was hunting. He's employed as a hunter by corporate counsel to gun down children, especially black children, since the 1924 Racial Integrity Act and the 1947 National Security Act that maintain that all humans are enemies of the state. I'll continue reading. Their account aligns with what other witnesses have said, that Brown's hands were raised in the air when he was killed. The contractor said they did not see how the incident began. The video was filmed on a cell phone by an unidentified witness and unreported. Legal experts told the network the video is going to be valuable evidence against Wilson, as it is a spontaneous recounting of the incident. Quote, they're saying that he was running from the police officer and that his hands were up, end quote, said Sonny Hostin, a CNN legal analyst and former federal prosecutor. Quote, I don't know what other witness testimony at this point or account we have to hear. The bottom line is having your hands up is a universal sign for surrender, end quote. This is on your turf. Ferguson, Missouri. A child should not have to surrender because there is a war being perpetrated against them by corporate counsel, according to the 1933 Emergency Banking Act. Sick. Absolutely horrifying.
They just love this litigation. They just love it. Attorney says SWAT lawsuit should go to trial. Evansville police officers investigating internet posts threatening law enforcement officials did not look into all of the usernames. But, of course, this attorney wants to litigate this out.
Absolutely.
Because he cashes in.
Yesterday, I was commenting on the article, and there was an FBI agent that came on. And give me a moment to pull that back up, because it was very interesting to see what he had to say while he was promoting racism. And this is what happens in these computer internet users. They're all agents. Look at what Master Lewis and his cronies have been doing. I mean, it's just, it's all the same schematic. It's all the same game. All the same
script. Well, speaking of which, perhaps we should review a few terms here. And you can find these at Wiki. But first of all, let me read, table...
9.
Table 9, the public law from the 12 tables. Number 5, under table 9, whoever incites a public enemy or whoever betrays a citizen to a public enemy shall be punished capitally.
Right, and that is actually the definition of treason and or sedition, as well as maintaining the war tactic of what is known as whisper campaigning. And everybody's got knowledge of whisper campaigns. There's this rumor flying about this or that actress or this or that politician or this or that legislator or this or that mayor. The majority of what came upon Rob Ford was whisper campaigning. Drug use is not unlawful. It's only unlawful or illegal under the Acts of Commerce or Commercial Crimes 27 CFR 72.11, which says that whoever's using or distributing them is actually undercutting Congress. And the majority of what came upon Rob Ford was simply that tactical play through the mainstream media in order to discount him, put him down upon his knees. And then we're seeing as that goes along throughout the campaign, as it gets worse and worse, and now he's under more charges and he's been in and out of rehab and all of these exciting things are happening. But this guy's being rendered right in front of everybody's eyes.
Yeah, absolutely. Now he's not rerunning in his bid for the mayor because he's been diagnosed with a stomach tumor, I guess.
Absolutely. He's sick. They've perpetrated all of this warfare against him, and of course his body is going to be reacting, and it feels bad, and of course he runs right to the medical industry, and they give him a diagnosis so that he can spend more of his money through the same system of redistribution. And they did that with your mom. We watched that in real time with your mom when she started feeling the aches and pains of being elderly and not being as physical with her husband and blah, blah, blah. What eventually culminated out of that was that the doctor told her that she had cancer and described the symptoms. She didn't have any symptoms before that. And at that time, they never did any testing the evidence cancer at all. What they did was they treated her with chemotherapy, and then they gave her radiation, and ultimately her body died. It gave out. But it was an attempt to redistribute her assets, cash in on the insurance derivatives, cash in on the death derivatives on the back end, and provide for corporations to be on corporate welfare, which is the whole schematic since the 1933 bankruptcy.
Yeah, she never had cancer. It said that right in their own medical reports. They just plow through.
But see, stress makes us feel icky. You know, we get tummy aches.
The pathology report. We read the pathology report out of my mom's own doctor's records, medical records. There was never any cancer to begin with. They just start hitting her with all this radiation, and she bought into the concept. And then
she was under stress. Here's Rob Ford. He's got fourth-generation warfare all around him. Low-intensity conflict, people pretending to be his friends while they're rolling on him. And, of course, he feels yucky. That makes you feel bad inside, and the doctors rely on that. He ran out to the doctor, and my guess is he's got absolutely no pathology either. This is genocide. This is how it works.
Yeah, in the last hour, we were talking about, how these people at the top, okay, what you hear spun as the oligarchs and globalists, blah, 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 all those smokescreen terminology things. But this story here from the Daily Mail, this kind of hits that nail on the head. Hedge fund hotshot gets his three children their own lawyer to protect their interests in bitter $5.6 billion divorce from mother who claims she was bullied into prenup. The hedge fund billionaire is attempting to prohibit his wife from getting her hands on his $5.6 billion fortune in her divorce proceedings, has recently hired a new lawyer for his three minor children. Kenneth Griffith, 45, had asked the court to appoint a children's representative in his divorce against his wife of 11 years, Ann Diaz Griffin, pictured left here in this picture with Kenneth, who protected their interests. This comes as Mr. Griffin, 45, is trying to get away with only paying out what he laid out in the couple's prenup, a cash settlement that amounts to about 1% of his wealth and does not include real estate, like their $15 million penthouse apartment in Chicago, or the couple's art collection. The two were married in 2003 in a lavish ceremony at Hameau de la Reine, an estate built for Marie Antoinette in Versailles.
Versailles, yeah. Interesting.
Versailles, yeah.
You know, if only they knew about your quitclaim. Why would he have to hire attorneys to protect
his
children's
assets? How much are they going to suck out of that $5.6 billion? Much as they can.
Absolutely. When it could just be settled really quickly by filing a quitclaim.
But I don't care. This guy's a hedge fund hotshot. Okay? Describe for our listeners what that means if you're in hedge funds.
He's a monster. He's been hedging the bet against humanity. That's what it's all about. Hedging the bet, of course, are hedge funds in each community. They're guaranteed because it's the same corporate counsel over everything going through, such as CSI, the Court Sciences Incorporated. choreography working in all of these cases, and it's a sad day for Roman citizens, apparently. Sick.
Yes.
You have to have an attorney to protect your children's assets from your ex-wife.
Why do people still have any high regards for these quote-unquote bankers, hedge fund managers, attorneys, judges, lawmakers? Okay. These are the people that are tricking out. And you go out every 2 or 4 years and vote for these critters? I mean, are you insane, people? Wake up. Now, I'm getting really sick of hearing all this campaign news coming out now because we go into another season, you know, kind of like the NFL. We're going into the campaign season now. Election season's on.
Oh, we got to talk about some patriotism then. From the big story, AP.org, autopsy. Inmate died from heat meds in New York cell. New York, from the AP, the death of a mentally ill, homeless former Marine in a 101-degree New York City jail cell was caused by hyperthermia due to environmental exposure to heat, according to a spokeswoman for the medical examiner who ruled the February death an accident on Friday. So it's okay in the United States Incorporated to cook human beings to death. As long as they're diagnosed for corporate counsel, isn't it? This is sick stuff. This is what patriot. He was a former Marine. Why is he mentally ill? Because he was a former Marine. It's a guarantee. It's in the bag. Corporate counsel is absolutely going to cash in. When they get out of the military, what's the first thing that happens? They file their DD-214 right down at the Register of Deeds, County Property Department Office, Property. It's just so sick. Stop filing your DD-214s anywhere. Don't register anywhere. What you're doing is you're putting yourself back into the chute after you, quote, think you're serving your country, and you're not. You're just killing your brother on behalf of the bankers, maintaining these wars. And enough is enough. Another human being has been cooked inside of a jail maintained by the U.S. Incorporated. This is worse than Nazi Germany. Hitler did not cook people. He killed them through gas chambers and firing squads, which is, it's an execution. It's horrifying, but it's still not as bad as cooking somebody in a jail cell, for Christ's sakes. This is the second time this year.
Yeah. We started off the show, or you did, with the story about that guy lost his feet in Denver.
He lost five of his toes due to the actions of the prisons.
Commercial, and he was jailed for commercial crime.
Misdemeanors. And
never harmed anybody.
Right.
But the Confederacy, under the guise of that jail, sure did.
Right. And again, for excuse me, but for hedge fund managers and CD holders, when he's a deposit into your bank, you know better than to alter his composition. That's the foundational rule of special deposit. So you have a lot coming to you and a lot more than you're expecting. Just wait for it, because I am not done, and I will not be done until all of humanity is safe.
But yeah, people still just glorify all their captors. I mean, I'm getting tired of seeing all these headlines about Prince Harry. Prince Harry this. Here's the latest one. Go on, lads. Prince Harry watches the basketball on day 3 of Invictus game alongside U.S. Vice President's wife, Jill Biden. One of your favorites.
Yeah.
The pair could be seen cheering and clapping in the stands as they watched the wheelchair basketball in the Copper Box Arena at London's Queen Elizabeth Park. Queen Elizabeth's Park.
Yeah.
They were all
smiles.
She's
on welfare. That actress is on welfare, it says. She's on welfare through the House of Commons. She's not even... She doesn't receive any royalties at all. She's not a queen.
Right. I should clarify about Prince Harry. He's not an oligarch. He's really a figurehead for the oligarchs.
Right.
But your patriotism to him is supporting the whole
Congress.
Yeah.
the whole concept. And it's so amazing to see, especially this last couple of years, as it's been coming out that her welfare benefits are being lowered. And this is, we're talking about this high-paid, high-dollar actress welfare benefits. And she still can't live on what she's been given through the House of Commons and everything else, because she's used to being that worshipped actress. And these things are just interesting.
But you brought up supporting the whole system here with this limited dresses. They were all smiles as they enjoyed the action on the third day of the event, which sees wounded serving or veteran servicemen and women from across the globe. So, you know, there's
baby kissing.
They're giving, yeah,
PR.
Lip service, PR to, you know, these, to keep this, keep the, you know, mindless grunts or whatever Kissinger called the soldiers, you know, to keep them being patriotic to the system and believing they have a reason to go into these countries at the behest of Congress and, off people, as we saw in Iraq and Afghanistan. It seems like more civilians, women and children, were killed than enemy combatants.
Absolutely, and you hit the nail on the head when you said they're just mindlessly following these folks and patronizing. And to all of our listeners, you can find this at archive.org. The details, Aldous Huxley, The Ultimate Revolution. And I'd like to read a quote from that speech because it sums it up. Quote, "And it seems to me perfectly in the cards that there will be, within the next generation or so, a pharmacological method of making people love their servitude and producing a kind of painless concentration camp for entire societies, so that people will in fact have their liberties taken away from them, but will rather enjoy it, because they will be distracted from any desire to rebel by propaganda, brainwashing, or brainwashing enhanced by pharmacological methods," end quote. And of course, that's Aldous Huxley. He did this speech, I believe it was in 1960 at Stanford. But he said, look, it's coming. You guys are going to mindlessly, follow these folks and patronize your captors because you're all drugged up. And of course, within the last month or so, they released, the psychiatrist actually released information maintaining that they've been putting lithium in the water, and now they're testing it to see how well their plan is working, because if there's less suicide rates, well, then that means that people are enjoying their servitude and they're not spiking out, and the psychiatrist can cash in.
And sure enough, 9/11 came along, and buildings fell at free fall speed, which should not have occurred. Building 7 goes down 20 minutes after the BBC reported it, and we've got dancing Israelis. We've got the terrorists who were found alive and well in Saudi Arabia. You know, the quote-unquote terrorists, I should say, and. You know, all this evidence to suggest this thing was a huge hoax, and yet the people just, 90% of them,
they're,
you know, to still to this day say, oh yeah, them terrorists, yeah, Al-Qaeda got us, so we got to go in. And then they sell them this cock and bull story about going into Iraq, you know, with against Saddam Hussein, and Al-Qaeda wasn't even there. I mean, it was ridiculous.
Absolutely.
And people just fell for it hook, line, and sinker.
They were all drugged up. They're all offered, marijuana is illegal, alcohol is bad for you, and then, come here, honey, let me give you some Seroquel or some Valium or Xanax, and you're eating these things in your food. If you go to the Codex Alimentarius and look at their index, go through your pantry, go through your fridge, and you'll find that you're already doped up by metabolizing, such as sodium benzoate, potassium benzoate, calcium benzoate.
That stuff's in everything, too.
Everything. And it metabolizes immediately into benzodiazepine. Immediately. You're all doped up on Valium, Xanax, and you have no idea. And that is what makes you comfortable. That is what makes you fall back on the easier-to-believe truth. That is what makes it so that you can sit there on your couch and watch as your brothers and sisters are slaughtered before your eyes by FBI and corporate counsel. General counsel.
And the media tells you it was the terrorists.
Absolutely.
And you go, yeah, we got to get them. Thank God for our president who's going to declare war on terrorism, which is another cock and bull concept because that war can never end.
Absolutely. Unless you end it. You're so damn drugged up. I mean, this is just deplorable. Big story, AP.org, U.S. Border Agency, 155 force cases need more review. San Diego, the agency that oversees U.S. Border Patrol, said Friday that an initial review of cases involving use of force and alleged misconduct by agents and inspectors found 155 that merit further investigation. Mark Morgan, interim head of Customs and Border Protection's Internal Affairs Office, said there was no timeline to complete the review, and Commissioner R. Jill Karolowski has not decided what information to release on individual cases. One case resulted in death. Morgan, an acting assistant commissioner, is a longtime FBI official who was named on the job in June amid widespread criticism that Border Patrol agents use excessive force and that CBP is slow to investigate and lacks transparency. CBP examined 860 cases since 2009, including most of the 67 involving deadly force that are addressed in a highly critical CBP Commission report released in May. The report by the Police Executive Research Forum said some agents were suspected of intentionally placing themselves in an escape route of fleeing vehicles to create justification to fire weapons, and that some shootings of rock throwers were questionable, especially when attackers hurled projectiles from across the border in Mexico. There was never a threat to your life when you killed them. CBP also reviewed cases in a report by the American Immigration Council that details a wide range of alleged abuses, from agents kicking a pregnant woman who later miscarried to knocking someone's head against a rock. Reasons for further investigations may include questions about whether a case could have been handled differently, perhaps by not standing in the way of a fleeing vehicle, abandoning a high-speed pursuit, or using a non-lethal weapon, Morgan told reporters in Washington. Now, folks, these are not dehumanized anything. This is speaking about the slaughter of human beings and the justification that the federal government comes up with to sell you that this is a good idea. The FBI is ISIS. The FBI is Al-Qaeda. The FBI is on the ground everywhere, slaughtering human beings and pointing the finger at you and your brother so that you justify the slaughter. These are the foundational rules of genocide. They're just following the rules to a T. Policy.
Yep. Poly means many. CY, stemming from the word side or to kill. To kill many. How do you like that policy now? You know?
From JDNews.com, JDNews.com, nurse co-worker and mother arrested on drug charges. Raleigh, the State Bureau of Investigation says a Jacksonville nurse used her former employer's medical practice to illegally obtain and sell prescription painkillers. The SBI arrested Julie Bucci, 47, on September 10th for allegedly using the names of her mother, deceased husband, and her own name on fraudulent prescriptions for Dilaudid and hydrocodone, that one's an anti-seizure med, and then filled the bogus prescriptions at pharmacies. The SBI and the Onslow County Sheriff's Office charged Bucci following a six-month investigation of Bucci and co-worker Bobby Joe Smale, 31, of Jacksonville. Bucci's mother, Rebecca R. Rhodes, 73, of Jacksonville, was also charged for picking up the drugs for Bucci from the pharmacy. Small was arrested September 9th. Bucci was a registered nurse and Smale a receptionist at a Jacksonville's physician office when their employer discovered they were stealing from prescription pads and calling pharmacies on behalf of the practice to obtain the drugs. The employer reported the women to the police. Bucci was charged with 36 counts of obtaining controlled substances by forgery and 36 counts of level 3 trafficking by possession of opiates. She was booked into the Oslo County Jail under a $3.6 million bond. She will appear in court on Thursday. Rhodes was arrested on 2 counts of obtaining controlled substances by forgery, 2 counts of level 3 trafficking by possession of opiates. She was held in the Oslo County Jail under a 200,000 FRN bond. Smell was charged with illegally obtaining a total of 4,000 of oxycodone, a street value of $40,000 since 2012 by using forged prescriptions. Sick. They're like a plague. All of these nurses that pretend to love people, killing them by prescriptions.
Yeah, and a lot of these actions are just instilled upon them due to policy. Okay? Now, speaking of policy, this story here, this is really real policy and commercial crimes. It's under the category of, but this just came out today at Breitbart. Mysterious heavily armed men dropped from helicopters to destroy marijuana fields. A group of unknown heavily armed men dressed in camouflage have been dropped from helicopters into marijuana fields in Mendocino County in order to chop down plants and eradicate growing operations. All right, now why do you suppose this is? According to CBS San Francisco KPIX, one of the groups conducting such raids is private security contractor Lear Asset Protection and Management. A Lear spokesman acknowledged the group had conducted similar raids in Mendocino County over the last year. However, medical marijuana growers Susan Schinder of KPIX that a group of men who used helicopters to raid her field last month refused to identify themselves.
Absolutely not. They're a criminal organization. They don't want to be found
out. Yeah, look at this. There's no paperwork.
Absolutely.
There are no copies of any warrants.
Absolutely.
There were no inventories left of what they took, Schinder said.
They're a criminal enterprise. They're making a killing off of the drug trafficking. And they bring these charges forth reliant on your patriotism. That's the only thing that allows them to still be operating.
Well, what I was going to say is, what are you allowing them to do anything to your plants for in living in that world of civil death? You've abjured the realm by saying that Congress has rights over your land.
Absolutely.
And how do you give them rights over your land? Well, you go and vote for them, register. You're evidencing yourselves to be in league with the Confederacy instead of evidencing yourself to be a sovereign state. That's the only way to hold them accountable. They're a fiction. They can't own anything. But you keep allowing it over and over again because you've abjured the realm. Now, we evidence that they're the ones that are dead. They've abjured the realm now because they're just a bunch of dead, civilly dead entities claiming to be a sovereign state. They never were a sovereign state. They only told you that, and you believed it, because, oh, they're the mighty United States of America.
They have
or
a flag. They have their own flag.
The mighty country of Canada. The mighty country of Australia. They've got flags.
It symbolizes their authority. I was captured by pirates.
They're all run by Eric Cartman, saying, you respect my authority.
Authority. I wanted to follow up on that Dr. George Visnick that we brought up yesterday because it was interesting what he put on his Facebook wall. First of all, we'll cover the letter he wrote to his employee when she found out she had cancer. This is dated on August 11, 2014. It starts out, Carol, you are currently engaged in a battle against cancer that will be demanding physically, mentally, and emotionally. The symptoms of the disease, the pain medications you will need, and the side effects of the chemotherapy will be significant and distracting. You will not be able to function in my office at that level required while battling for your life. Because of this, I'm laying you off without pay. As of August 11, 2014, your last paycheck will be mailed to you this Friday, 8/15/14. Our thoughts and prayers are with you as you fight this horrible disease. Thanks for your time at Fishnick Oral Surgery. I hope you battle. Your battle is swift, smooth, and successful. Signed by, as always, Dr. Visnich, V-I-S-N-I-C-H. Just after this story broke, we covered that on the Public Law last night, and CNN came out with an update. And in that update, Huffington Post, it had relayed to George Visnick's Facebook page. Now, he's got a lockdown. However, I went to that page and I shared one of his comments before he locked his site down. And this comment says, and this is from George Visnick Oral Surgery's status, and you can find that on my Facebook wall by going to Facebook, Tammy.Pepperman, of course. And he says, very simply, "This is for all you bleeding hearts. Go on and send her some of your own money." And he posted a link to a site for donations for this female. He has absolutely no compassion whatsoever. He's absolutely devoid of emotion. And this is just foul. And now he's whining in the media that he's receiving threats and everything else. He's not a human being, my goodness. How dare he do this to somebody? She's on her knees. This is the hardest time of her life, and he lets her go, lays her off, like, I mean, that's the bottom of the barrel right there. Sick.
Yeah, that's typical mentality, if you ask me, in my opinion. Well, what do you think about all this demonization still goes on about the Federal Reserve, especially since we came in and... did what we did. Now the patriotic media out there.
Well, it's
the Fed has
show.
A big surprise waiting for you. But this is from Zero Hedge. But the truth is, there is no recovery. It's just a scene in play, and the economy is completely shot.
No, markets are great right now. We just took over the Federal Reserve by default.
Exactly, and people don't understand what the Federal Reserve is yet. Maybe we can spend a little bit of time on either Monetary Trust or Regal, but let me read the rest of this. It only appears to be left standing because the Fed poured oodles of money into it, or rather into a part of the economy that it can control, that it can get the money out of, again, easily. Wall Street banks and Wall Street equals the Fed. Well, I don't know. Why don't you break that down a little bit?
We're not
advocating getting rid of the Federal Reserve now.
No.
Not now that the
unwinding
that the Federal Reserve note is backed by the attorneys and corporations,
right.
Judges, lawmakers, and other fictions.
And that's what the unwind is about. This is unwinding. What they were doing was they were human trafficking and perpetrating genocide, and they were caught out. And so the Federal Reserve was taken over by the United States. And in this, the new thing that backs those Federal Reserve notes is indeed criminal. It can only be a criminal, somebody who has harmed a human being under the public law. And in this, of course, they're whining and they want it to fail now. Remember when it first happened, they wanted to get rid of the Fed finally. And I was like, oh my gosh, that is so freaking funny. They sure didn't want to get rid of that Fed before we found him guilty and of all of these things.
Oh, no. That was, what they had done is they usurped this eleemosynary trust with their fake, false ecclesiastical law. They usurped the ecclesiastical law is what they did. And what they called ecclesiastical law was not. All
right,
we went back to the original ecclesiastical law, which is under the public law.
Absolutely, and under the treasury. You cannot take money out of the treasury unless you are using that for human beings. Eleemosynary, defined in Black's Law Dictionary, first edition, 1891, relating to the distribution of alms, bounty, or charity, charitable. Now, That's not theirs.
But who's been getting the charity?
Corporate welfare. Yeah. It's been
under corporate welfare
since
and that 14th Amendment.
1933, corporations have been on corporate welfare. An eleemosynary corporation, such as are constituted for the perpetual distribution of the free alms and bounty of the founder in such manner as he has directed, and then the class or ranked hospitals for the relief of poor and impotent persons, and colleges for the promotion of learning and piety, and the support of persons engaged in literary pursuits. These corporations are lay and not ecclesiastical, even though they're composed of ecclesiastical persons, and although they in some things partake of the nature, privileges, and restrictions of the ecclesiastical body. See, they've been pretending to be the church since Matthew 27. Here's Governor Pilate, and he washes his hands in holy water, and he turns to the priest and he says, "You're going to absolve me of this, right? I mean, it looks great on paper. We're going to build us some proper cemeteries, and we're going to have free legal aid programs. It'll be funded over there off the backs of that prisoner and that prisoner and that prisoner, and we're going to maintain human trafficking since the inception of politics."
Also, fraudulent assignments done by the female, usually.
Absolutely, and all of these things have now come to a halt because it was... I mean, even here, in Black's Law Dictionary, first edition, Congress had raided the Treasury. And by 1891, I'll just read the definition of the Treasury because it's very interesting that... They had raised it down to less than £1 million. £1 million in 1891. They had sucked it all dry. And what the purpose of a treasury for, of course, is for human beings, the public good, public trust. And it was being maintained for corporate welfare. And it sucked into all these departments and offices and divisions and, you know, you name it. And not one penny was ever going back into the treasury. Those were the rules. If you do not use this money for human beings, and there's any left over, put it back in the treasury. They just devised a schematic through the IRS, through the 1789 Judiciary Act, through the Preservation Acts, through all of these acts, pretending to be protecting human beings while putting them on social welfare at less than 1%, way less than 1%. It's like a point, 1% of 1% that they were actually putting back into humanity while they were all cashing in and embezzling from the House of Lords, the original Treasury.
And they didn't want you to see this, and the evidence is in Black's Law, first edition itself. Go to second or third or fourth, and all of a sudden, Treasury... is either redefined or not there.
Right. It's the same with bank. By the fifth edition, the definition had changed over into the commerce side. You know, it didn't maintain in big letters. This is a courtroom, folks. I mean, these things are just so profound that it can go on.
It's a court of public opinion, and they sold you your opinion.
Right, and that's...
They rammed it right down your throat and got you to buy it.
That's a metaphor of what happened in the garden. I'll have to define treasury. You can find that at TammyPepperman.org this week. Be well, everybody. See you next Wednesday. Bone Rocco Show. Be well.